Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
You there in the tunic. Yes, come closer, my friend.
No, I'm good. Hey, everybody. It's a wonderful sunny day out here in the Icarian Bazaar, full of fascinating characters of questionable repute.
Do you seek teleportation, enhanced self-propulsion, or trans-dimensional travel?
Maybe later. Ah, gnomes. Can't live with them. Anyway, I'd like to talk to you about a product a step above these merchant swayers, BattleBards. Featuring state-of-the-art sound design, BattleBards has the best audio for your role-playing experience. It'll make your game come alive.
Are you the saint, searching for the salve that grants everlasting life?
Not right now. Busy recording on my magical sound collector. And the sound mixer makes all your audio come together for a scene-stealing experience.
If you died whilst wearing one of these armors, you deserved it.
You just bought one. And as a listener to Delve, you can get even more audio for signing up. I'll tell you how at the end of the show. BattleBards, hearing is believing.
These here are the finest weapons ever wrought by mortal hands.
Oh, fine, I'll take a look.
Heavy battle axes from the dwarven holds of the Iron Hills.
Oh, here we go.
Deadly leafback arrow.
Yep.
The elven kingdom of Thalia.
Wow, cool.
Folded steel swords from the fabled forges of Reldeland.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan.
And I'm Alex.
And, Alex, I have a question. Are you good at following rules?
Sometimes.
How often?
Whenever I'm not driving.
Whenever you're not driving?
Yeah.
Sure. All right, so, But you know what? I know someone who decided to come onto the show again. He's decided to brave us one more time to explain a little bit about reading rules. And that man is Dustin Depenning, the creator of Synthesize. And Dustin, thank you for being back on the show.
Hey, thanks for having me again.
Oh, it's no problem. It feels like you were here not too long ago, and usually people need at least like a year break between times talking to us, but not you. You are a trooper. You came back without hesitation. Well, maybe yeah. A little.
It's maybe a slow month. It's a slow month.
Well, you know, that's how we get most of our guests on.
I don't have anything better to do. Might as well go on the show again.
That's how we get most of our guests. It's okay. But Dustin, you said that you wanted to talk a little bit about reading rules. So can you explain that to me? Because I'm not very familiar with like the actual creation of rules in the first place. So what are you talking about when you're talking about reading rules?
Yeah, it's a big part of the modern RPG scene. You know, a lot of people are finding out about games online. So, you know, D&D and a lot of other games that have, you know, these huge generations gapping fan bases, you know, you have a lot of ways to learn the game orally where, you know, people play with each other, teach each other how to play. Mm. So, reading rules actually wasn't a big part of the RPG experience other than referencing when there was a disagreement and you weren't willing to let the GM just make up whatever he wanted. So, but now that people are, you know, buying PDFs all the time for games they've never played before, you know, trying to learn and then teach the game to try to get a chance to play it, you know, reading rules is a really big part of RPG experience nowadays.
I can completely agree with that. There have been plenty of times for me, for instance, where you're getting new players into games or you're playing a game. Like, if I were to say pick up your game, Synthesize, I would have to read that because I've never played it. No one I know has ever played it. So it's one of those things that is really, you don't actually think about it as much, I feel.
Right.
When you're sitting down to decide to play a game. But you're right, it is actually really important.
So help me out a little bit here, because as everyone who's ever listened to the show knows, I have no idea what RPGs really are. So, it's fun that way. But what I gather, I mean, from kind of hearing about people talk about RPGs once upon a time, is a lot of it had to do with basically GM input. Like, the rules were not so big. It really had everything to do with what your game master or dungeon master was putting into it. And the rules were just kind of there. So that's changed.
Well, I think the rules were always important, but it was the way that the rules were learned is what's been changing. Early on, back when people didn't have a lot of internet and had a lot of time on their hands to read, and RPGs were brand new, reading rules was a really big deal because no one knew how to play D&D because no one had played it before. But then once you got those first, you know, crop of players who read the game and learned the game, they were able to orally teach, you know, a whole other slew of players. And so, you know, a lot of people, you know, come at role-playing games only ever having read, you know, some of the story and then, like, the, you know, some of the stuff about building a character and not ever reading, like, the core rules to the game, and they kind of learn those on the fly. But I think, you know, like, even, you know, traditional, like, old-school, original D&D, you know, still had tons of charts and stuff that the Game Master was supposed to use and constantly look at. But they didn't have rules for every situation. So when players wanted to do something that wasn't covered by the rules, then, yeah, it really did come down to the GM just making up whatever they wanted to make up. Rules have always been central to the experience. It's just the way that the rules are learned and experienced that has kind of gone through this inverse curve where at the beginning everyone had to read, then a lot of people just learned from each other, and then now people are back to having to read because they're trying out new games that have never been played.
I see. Okay. So now that actually brings, I'll bring back to the way, way back for a second.
Way back.
From the way back, the long, long ago? Yeah. So since I have Dustin, I imagine you've played role-playing games for quite a while now.
Yes.
Okay. And Alex, I know you've played role-playing games for quite a while now.
Yes.
Okay, good. And I have not. So I'm going to ask the two of you, when you first started playing role-playing games, was reading rules a big part of that, or was your experience basically that the game master was going to tell you what to do?
For me, I learned how to play the game through other people before I ever got my hands on a book. I'm young. I'm only like 30, which to a lot of like grognard RPG guys, that's like super young. And I started playing with third edition Dungeons and Dragons. And the only reason you started reading the rules in that game was this, you know, thirst for power. So, you know, you didn't have to read the rules. You could get by without reading the rules. But if you desired to, quote unquote, get better at the game, you know, make characters that were better and stronger and could do cooler stuff, then you had to start reading the rules to really understand what were the best choices for your character. You know, it wasn't necessarily a fun experience to read those rules because, you know, a lot of relevant rules were scattered all over the place and, you know, hidden in paragraphs. Like, you might be paragraph explaining a circumstance and then the rule that pertains to that circumstance is like hidden in the third or fourth sentence.
The good days of 3.0.
Yes.
Yeah. So just out of curiosity, what changed between 3.0 and 3.5?
You know, I actually didn't really myself play in 3.0. I think I had started during 3.5, and the first books I got my hands on were 3.5. So I think Dustin might be better able to answer that one.
Yeah, 3.0 is basically like, here's a brand new way to play D&D where we make all the math easier and get rid of THACO and all this other stuff. And then, but they hadn't really, you know, thoroughly hammered out the rules as well as they should have. And 3.5 was basically like a patch where they were like, oh, we want to use the same core system, but we want to do a slightly better job. So we're going to redo fighters to make them a little better than they were. And we're going to redo how rangers work. And, you know, there's just, you know, the game got wildly, crazily unbalanced quickly in 3.0. And then 3.5, the game was still crazy and could get unbalanced quickly, but, you know, they had a little more semblance of trying to design the rule set.
Okay, so it was like a software patch before there was
It was like a UI update.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Okay.
I know from the 3.0 books I've looked at, like the DMG and the Player's Handbook, you can tell the visually they are different. Like, not just from the covers, but you can look in the book and just the way they stylized it and presented the information was different.
Right.
And 3.5 did a lot better job of doing that. But even so, like today, I'll look through a book and I'll read a rule and I'll be like, wait, that's how that works? I've always never played it like this.
Yeah, because there's a lot of rules for specific situations and a lot of people just use the house rules instead of what's actually in the book.
Oh yeah, like the weapon specialization feat for 3-5, which is only supposed to be a fighter feat. I've always played that as any character can get it. Didn't read that part, because my DM never said that part, so... back to your original question, too, where you asked us both. I actually started playing in high school, because I'm about the same age as Dustin here, because we're both about 30, I guess. But I had started playing RPGs with friends at school without using books, and we went from that to 3.5. And so my first time playing was without a book, without a character sheet, without dice.
Whoa, and okay.
Yeah, it's crazy stuff. And then we got into the books and the stuff, and I quickly learned by the book because my DM was terrible.
Yeah, that might cloud your judgment of your original experiences, too.
So to turn the question around for you, though, Nathan, for instance, your first time playing D&D with me, did you read the rule book?
I did not.
You did not.
I pretty much assumed that you were not going to screw me over. I should have known better, but no. My first time, and really the only time I played a role playing game was when you said, "We're gonna help you make a character. We're gonna do the scenario. We're gonna kind of skip a lot of the prologue. We're gonna get right into the dungeon, and we're gonna lead you through it." So, in a lot of ways, that was completely my experience was completely denoted by the DM's your input into telling me what to do.
Well, I didn't tell you what to do. I helped you figure out what you're doing because you couldn't. Figure it out via the rules.
Right. Sorry, I should have explained that. You didn't tell me what to do, but when I wanted to do something, you explained how I do that.
Right. You learned orally because it's easier than reading a 150-plus page rule book and trying to figure out for yourself.
This is true. Now, I just heard how you started reading the rule books. Dustin, when was the first time that you really started to realize that reading rules was going to be important? What role-playing game did you actually start reading with rules for?
So I started with reading 3.5 because I was playing with power players who were constantly reading the rules and building these crazy characters that were really strong, and my characters were like weak pieces of crap compared to their characters.
Yeah.
And so I was like, whoa, shit, I better start reading the rules. So then I got into it, and then it was mostly just reading to learn how to build characters. And then I didn't start really learning the rules for like deeper reasons other than characters until Eberron came out. And then like the setting of Eberron was really exciting and interesting to me. So I tried to learn as much as I could about it and a lot about the game so I could start dungeon mastering. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's when I started getting deeper in the rules. And then I quickly discovered as I was learning the rules that I'm like, you know, a lot of game designers have this sort of arrogance about them where when they start to experience stuff, they're like, oh, I don't like that. I want to do it differently, or I want to do that differently, or this isn't how I would have said that. And I quickly had that experience with Eberron, and then also, you know, the rest of 3.5 D&D where I was like, it would be much more interesting if the rules worked this way. So I immediately started getting interested in designing rules. And then that just blossomed into when I picked up D20 Modern, because I was still a 20-sided die nerd. I was, you know, kind of wary of switching to non-D20 role-playing games. I didn't know anybody who played non-D20 role-playing games. I checked out D20 Modern, which was kind of almost like Wizards version of GURPS, where they were like, we're going to make a more generic system that can then be used and modified for a bunch of different settings. You know, you can you know, the core setting is modern day, but you can do historical, you can do pulp fiction, you can do sci-fi, you can do all this sort of stuff. Mm. And so I got really into reading those rules just so I could understand, what version of the game I wanted to run. And then I would, you know, make up a lot of my own rules to kind of tweak it even further to be exactly what I wanted.
Oh, okay. So, very different experiences, like, with actual rule reading. It does make me kind of wonder, like, when they originally came out with the first Dungeons & Dragons, do you think they thought that was going to be a problem? Like, maybe people aren't even going to read the rules. They're just going to make it up as they go.
Totally. No. They're, you know, the best thing people had to entertain themselves with other than the radio and TV was electronic football. So... You know, like, people read and people learned the rules to games. Like, board games from that era had really complicated rules. Mm. You know, board games now, if your rules are longer than half a page, people check out, you know, unless you're a hobbyist. If you're, like, a board game hobbyist, you know, you're going to play the game with a 5 to 20 page rule book. You're not worried about that. But, you know, your average person isn't going to, you know, read past half a page because they'd rather be... watching the game, watching the movie, playing on their phone, so on and so forth.
That's true. And you better have pictures. You need to have pictures and diagrams. I learned that the hard way when I tried to play with people who are really used to just Yahtzee. Like, here's a new fun game. It's called Carcassonne. And everyone's like, what is the Carcassonne? And it's like, okay. Well, luckily that is one page. And there's diagrams. See, you can look at it. So that's helpful.
See, the problem with that, though, is most, not all, most RPGs have way more than one page of rules.
Yeah, I'll give you that. And speaking of which, Dustin, I'm guessing that Synthesize has a pretty extensive rule book.
Yeah, it does. The core rules needed to play the game probably... under 20 pages, but once you put in equipment and player powers and optional rules and story, you know, background story about different stuff, and then, like, you know, advanced rules for, like, vehicle combat and stuff like that, yeah, the game's over 200 pages.
Ooh, okay. Yeah, but I mean, I guess at the end of that 200 pages, you know everything that you are going to need to know. About the game,
and you can totally play the game having only read, you know, less than 20, because some of that 20 pages is stuff the game master needs to know that the players don't need to know.
Oh, okay. So that actually is interesting, now that you mentioned that. The rules that you have to design for a GM versus for a player. So what do you have to do to write rules for a DM?
You know, that's a good question. I kind of approach, you know, maybe it's not the right thing to do, but I kind of approach them the same. I just, you know, for the GM, I'm writing explicit rules about, you know, here's how you figure out how to balance things. Here's how you interact with your players. Here's how you make judgment calls about what's good and what's bad. You know, my GM rules are more about, like, helping them structure the game and keep it moving. But they're written with the same, you know, reading level and complexity as the player-facing rules, which are like, here's how you make a character. Here's how you shoot a guy in the face. The difference is the player-facing rules are all about, like, here's how you do crazy fun stuff and, you know, run wild in the system. And then the GM rules are like, here's how you try to manage those cantankerous players.
You know? Here's how you go crazy. This is how you reel them in.
Yeah.
These are a little bit contentious, but they're going to be important.
I never really divided the rules, you know, like, oh, the player rules are way... simpler and the GM rules are way harder. Like, you know, I'm sure some games are more like that, where they try to, like, really minimize what the players need to know to play the game.
Right. Yeah, because I mean, imagine, like, the GM rules will always include the player rules because they have to know what the player is going to do. But they need to also just know, like, the ins and outs of the world that the player might not be privy to at the outset. So Alex, you get all that?
Yeah, no, I was going to say the way I approach writing rules is to keep it simple and concise. Basically, my target for rule writing is you, Nathan.
How did I know you were going to say that?
That's my view on it. I want the threshold of being able to understand the rules as simple as possible. I want to be able to hand it to Nathan, who has, again, had very little experience with most RPGs in tabletop format, and have him go, oh, I know how this works.
Yeah.
Because a lot of veteran players will read rules and they'll interpret how things work based on the other games they've played.
Right.
So I want it to be, all right, this is how the rule works. It's not really something you have to worry about interpretation on. It's, this clearly tells me how it works, and there's very little chance that you'll kind of get in a rules argument over something based on the placement of a comma or the wrong word in the wrong spot. Because you know us gamers, we'll do it.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that sounds terrific. Also, you still have work to do because I still can't understand your system. But
that's just because you're dumb.
Well, thanks. But, you know, I am your target audience. So
that's why on the thing it says to hit, you do this. And it tells you the exact thing you need to roll and how you do it right there on the sheet. So you don't have to remember it and you don't forget how to do it.
Perfect. I like this already. But I don't know. I mean, just a like side note, I think that having like an outsider look at your system is probably pretty useful, regardless of what you're doing, even if it's not in gaming. Just having an outsider point of view is kind of useful, because like when we started the show, you had a lot of veteran gamers that were going like, oh, yeah, that's a good question. We never think about that anymore. And then it's like, yeah, well, I don't know what I'm doing. So, you know, that's always the fun. At least I think it's fun. Is it fun, Al?
You sometimes think it's fun? I mean, that's Dustin. He's the one that's on the show again.
Sorry. Dustin, has it been fun so far?
Yeah, it's been fun.
Okay, good.
Does Nathan make you want to pull your hair out?
No.
No?
I deal with much worse at my day job, so.
Oh. Fair enough. Nathan, you need to try harder. We need to make our guests go bald.
Oh, that's okay. I'm going to get a frying pan and start hitting myself in the head a couple times. That would be great if I was actually a synth, but stop the robot uprising by crushing myself in the head. Okay, so back to the actual reading rules part. We have a lot of people that listen to the show that are fledgling developers. So I guess the two of you have designed some stuff. I've heard. Dustin, you actually have something people can play. Alex, not so much. I just needed to get that in, Alex. Sorry. Quick jab.
Thanks, Nathan.
Yeah, you're welcome. Just tips for people who are trying to actually write out how you play a game. What is your best advice for them?
Know your target and don't waste any words trying to reach that target. So, you know, Alex, you're doing the right approach, like figuring out who you want the game to be for and trying to write it out, you know, in the most concise way to explain it to them. When I did Synthesite, I made two choices. You know, they may not have been good choices because they might have been slightly limiting. But one choice was I didn't want to explain the fundamentals of tabletop role-playing games. A lot of books dedicate pages and pages to explaining the fundamentals.
What is role-playing?
Yeah, exactly. What is a game master? You know, like all that sort of stuff. And I made the decision that I didn't want to include that in my book because that wasn't who my game was for. My game was for people who already play role-playing games but want to try something new. And then I still made the decision to try to make my rules as clear as possible because I knew it was going to be a new game. And when they, you know, when they were learning how my game works, they needed to understand, you know, in as few words and as quickly as possible. So, like, when people have a background in role-playing games, know how to play Pathfinder, or know how to play GURPS, or, you know, World of Darkness, if they know how to play any basic, you know, traditional tabletop role-playing game, they can read my book and within the first 8 pages know exactly how my game works. And that was the intention. And sometimes people, you know, read the first 8 pages and go, wow, your game is so simple, it seems basic. So it's kind of a turnoff for some gamers, because they're like, where are the options? Where's all the crunchiness? Where's the meat? And they don't realize that that's baked into trying to let them have as much opportunity to play the game their way, and use the basic system to tell whatever story they want to tell in that universe, and know exactly what dice to roll and what to do at any given moment. But yeah, no, it's, you know, you got to figure out who your customer is, and then talk in the language that will be appealing to them. And you know, I think I actually missed the target a little bit on my game, because my game is meant for established gamers, but then I tried to make the game simple enough that established gamers could learn it quickly, but it leads them to thinking the game is overly simple when they learn it that quickly.
So you almost did your job too well, is basically what you're saying.
Right. And then, you know, then on the flip side, because I didn't explain the fundamentals of role playing, brand new gamers who might really appreciate how easy they wrap their head around the game, there are certain details missing. You know, they may not understand certain words I use or certain game conventions I use because they don't have experience with role playing games.
Okay. Excellent. So
yeah, I think for something like that, I agree with your approach to that, because you don't need 99% of the time, you're not going to need a what is a role playing, what is a games master. I see those in all the books, and I'm like, I feel like anyone who's picking this book up probably knows what those are. But at the same time, like you were saying, where you have some new gamers who don't necessarily know some of the terms, you could always have a glossary. Paralyzed is this. It means you can't move. You can't do anything, for instance. You know, right. Something like that might be helpful. Even if, like, yeah, you did something on your website, perhaps, for the newbie players, be like, hey, if you wanted more information on this, you can check out this. And it wouldn't have to be in the book. For newbies, that would be really helpful. For the veteran gamers, it's they kind of go, why are you including this? I already know this.
You know, there should be a book that's just like RPG terminology. Well, I think that actually might be useful for
me. If everyone used the same terms for every game, it would work.
That would be also helpful.
A lot of indie designers, you know, really challenge convention and don't use, you know, the term game master or player character or anything like that. And yeah, they might get mad if you tried to say, oh, this is how all RPGs work.
and the same thing for like your stats. Not everyone uses the same thing. Some will use strength or some will use physical.
Well, some RPGs don't even have stats.
Right, and that too. Or hit points or wounds or, you know, there's so many interchangeable variants that could mean almost the same thing but be slightly different that you couldn't actually write a complete compendium unless you included everything. And even then, you'd have some go, well, mine's slightly different than that definition.
So, like,
so basically, you're wrong. We should not make that.
Oh. So, maybe like a wiki page? There should be like an RPG wiki that's just all terms, and people could just add to it when they want. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Something. Maybe. See? Ha! Ha-ha! Anyway. Now, Dustin, you were talking about how, like, extra information occasionally has to get cut out so that you can simplify things. Do you have an example of something that was basically extraneous information in Synthesize that you had to cut out before the final product?
Yeah. There's both rules and story information that I cut out. There are rules for... what was one of the systems I ended up dumping? Well, I mean, I had so many versions of the vehicle rules, it was crazy. Like, I went through, like, 6 or 7 variants of the vehicle rules before I finally decided on the ones I wanted. I'm trying to remember. There was one, like, pretty big player interaction, like, rule thing that's just not even covered in the book. I'm trying to remember. Oh, yeah. I never explained balancing the game for... a group made up of highly different level characters.
That's
hard to do anyways, though.
Like, yeah, it is hard, but you can, you know, you can try to cover it, or you can at least address it. You can at least address that situation.
That's true. I mean, unless they've all got the same type of role, they're all combat characters, for instance. It's like, well, if I have something that's too low a level, the high levels will just crush it, and too high a level, and little guys will just kind of not do anything.
Right.
Is that why usually you see parties where everyone levels up pretty much at the same time?
It's nice to keep everybody. It's actually different because some of the older games, you always had to start at level one.
Yeah.
And when you would join a group, like someone would be a level 10 wizard and you're like, well, I'm a level one fighter. This sucks.
Yeah.
But they would explain how your character levels up way faster, you know, when you join a late group party, and then they would explain, you know, and the rules were balanced in such a way that a level one character, while they would quickly die, if they weren't careful, they could still participate and contribute. Because the math hadn't always completely gone off the rails, like in other, you know, later role-playing games where, like, a first level character cannot meaningfully interact with a 10th level character in any way. And, you know, once you have that in your game, which, you know, Synthesite, you know, it does have that, you know, linear dice progression. So, you know, you do end up in situations where a high level character is just so far ahead of a low level character that, you know, it's not a fun experience to put them in the same group. Yeah, you are going to run into situations where everyone's just like, okay, everybody levels up and everyone's the same level. And, oh, you're joining the campaign. You're going to start at the same level as everybody else. But I never explained that just because, you know, that's kind of convention that people, you know, try to stay within the same level, or, you know, when you join a group, you join at the level that the group is.
Because that sounds like something I would do. I would probably end up joining a group that's been playing for like 3 years or something and say, I'm joining in and I'm going to mess up your game. And they'll just leave me. They're like, hey, here's a boar. You go fight it. And then I'm dead.
I've killed people with boars before.
I know. I'm
dire
fully
boars,
aware.
Big boars.
That's true. Yeah. I know. Boar. Alex makes boar. Boar crushes elf. Alex kills bear. Bear kills boar. I think that's how it works, right?
Something like that.
Boar kills spider.
Sure.
Bears kill spider, yeah.
Sure. One other thing I was thinking when we were talking about the stuff you don't include, like the role-playing, what is role-playing? One of the things I think that should usually be included in a game up front, typically, which would at least be helpful, is what kind of game it is. Not necessarily, like, is it a role-playing game, whatever, but if it's a particularly role-play-heavy game, for instance, you might want to say that up front. Or if it's, you know, if it's a combat heavy game, or if it's like, this has equal parts combat and non-combat, you know, it's got this, just kind of explain what
Oh man, story gamers would be all over you for using the phrase non-combat. That's as if implying there's only two things in the world.
Combat and non-combat? Did you just assume my gaming role?
Yeah, did you just assume that those are the only two things there are to do, and that everything that isn't combat isn't good enough to stand on its own?
Well, I mean, in a lot of systems, I mean.
Yeah.
Oops.
Yeah. Oh, hashtag total pebble knockdown.
Maybe I want to play a game that's nothing but a dating sim.
Yeah.
Would that be considered combat or non-combat?
It depends on how badly you botch your charisma.
Depends how bad the blind date's going.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
But I mean, you know, early days of indie RPG design, you know, before, you know, the Forge and all those, you know, crazy designers that were really challenging the format, you know, people would, you know, make a game that was supposed to be a dating RPG game and just, like, use D&D rules, which are all geared for combat, and then, like, not think about, you know, how they should probably come up with completely new rules to, you know, explain this new experience they're trying to create.
Yeah. Yeah, because I'm sure that some of your stats don't really work too well for that.
Well, I mean, we could go into this on the show, but it gets into some strange territory.
No kidding. Okay, so my takeaway is you have to spend time on writing rules, and you have to be thinking about the people that read them. I think I get this now. Great.
Live long and prosper. That's a rule I try to follow and fail.
Spock would be very disappointed with you. So, Alex, if the folks out there who are not Vulcans want to find out more information about Delve, where could they go?
You can find out more information about Delve over at DelveCast.com.
And when you go there, you can also find some articles that were written by game developers. And we have some other stuff that's going to be hopefully coming on the site soon that you'll want to keep out a lookout for. Dustin, if folks want to learn more about either the rules or, I guess, the whole system of Synthicide, where could they go?
So you could go to SynthicideRPG.com. That's SynthicideRPG. And there you could learn a little bit about the game. You can also go to DriveThruRPG.com if you want to download the free starter adventure to get the basics of the rules. Or if you're feeling real happy, you can jump onto DriveThruRPG and buy the full game. The PDF is $22, and it's on sale right now.
Excellent. And you're taking pre-orders for the hardcover?
If you go to SynthicideRPG.com, there's a link that will take you to the backer kit page where you can pre-order the hardcover book.
Ah, beautiful, beautiful. If you would also like, you can find us on iTunes and Google Play. There are links at the bottom of the page if you would like to click on those too. If you can't find us otherwise, and please like us and comment and give us stars. I love stars. And you can also find us on a thing called Twitter. I hear it's making it's doing pretty well. The kids with their Twitters nowadays. You can find me at Citanium.
You can find me at EXP Limited, and you can find the show at Delve Podcast.
And Dustin, if I am correct, you are also on Twitter
at SynthicideRPG.
It's the same as the website. If you can get to the website, it's the same thing, but with an at symbol in front of it.
Yes.
Perfect. Excellent. You were smart that way. It makes it real easy. It's the same thing across like all platforms.
I tried.
You tried, you succeeded. That's important. Well, all right, everybody. I think the rules dictate that we have to end the show now.
Do they? We need to rewrite that rule.
We might have to take another pass at it.
Just one or two.
One or two?
Yeah.
All right. That's fair. But you know what? That's going to be time intensive, and we don't have the time right now. So Dustin, thank you for braving us yet again with such close proximity to the last time you were here. That is like something that has never been done before.
Well, last time I had to cut it short because I had a dinner date.
Yes, I remember this now. And you said to yourself, okay, I finally got out of this. You know what, though? I'm going back in. I am going back in, and we're going to do it again. You are a brave man, but you have not disappointed. And thank you for coming back on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me back on.
Oh, no problem whatsoever. And Synthicide, guys, you really should check it out because it is a really interesting concept and storyline. And the system that he has with actions is really cool, too. For all of us here at Delve, thank you for joining us. And we'll see you next time.
Peace.
Yeah, peace.
Peace.
I have no idea.
Misunderstanding.
Yep.
You have been listening to Dwarf Temple Prayer Eternal by Goof Parade, available on BattleBards. We thank BattleBards for sponsoring Delve. Go to BattleBards.com, create an account, make your first purchase, and during checkout, use coupon code DELVE1 for $10 and $25 packages to get a free track, DELVE2 on $50 and $100 packages to get 5 tracks, or DELVE3 for $150 and $300 packages to get 10 tracks. That's like getting a full album for free just by using the code. BattleBards.com, you'll love it.
All right, now I got to figure out how to close the show. I
had to figure it out last time talking to Breeze. You should listen to that and be like, hey, what happened here?
Yeah, not so easy.
I was just trying to be you. So I mean, it's a bad idea on my part.
Yeah, boy, it's crazy. Yeah, you don't want to get inside that head. No,
being you ain't easy.
No, it's not easy being me.
It's not easy being green.
It is not. I'm Kermit. Heidi ho. All right. So hi ho. We'll try. I'll try an outro that has nothing to do with Kermit the Frog. How about that?
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
You'd like that? Okay, great. So, Alex, why are there so many songs about rainbows? Okay.
You can't even do it without laughing.
All right. I could do it without laughing, but I'm not going to use it, so that's fine. All right.